The President. Members, please stand while the Chief Executive enters the chamber. And I'll call upon the Chief Executive to first address the Council. If you feel so inclined, Chief Executive, you may remove your mask. President, members, today is the 28th day of the last month before the Chinese New Year. This is the last legislative session before the Chinese New Year. I would like to take this opportunity to wish you a good year of the Year of the Rabbit, and I wish you all prosperity and health. First of all, I would like to take stock of what the new Hong Kong SAR government has done in the past 6 months since we have taken office. In the past 6 months, the whole team have been brought together towards a single goal, towards a result-oriented work. We complement each other's work. We are pragmatic. In the policy address in October, I have announced a number of innovative and effective measures, and I thank everyone in the government for their tireless work to implement these measures. I would like to go over some key initiatives. First, the setting up of the Steering Committee of Integration into National Development and the Steering Committee of the Northern Metropolis. We've had our first meeting. The next step is to dovetail the initiatives under the 14th Five-Year Plan, the development of the Greater Bay Area, as well as other national strategic developments. We want to use the Northern Metropolis as a development engine. Second thing is the setting up of the Office of the OASE, that is the Office for Attracting Strategic Enterprises. And we have also set up dedicated teams for attracting business and talents in Hong Kong to focus on attracting talents from other places. We will take a proactive approach. We will knock on doors to attract and compete for talents. We will also make use of innovative measures. We will be on the offensive to attract talents. We have also made use of the Top Talent Pass Scheme. We have received 5,800 applications. 70% of them have been approved, whereas the remaining applications are being processed. The Immigration Department and relevant departments under the Talent Services Unit will provide one-stop service for talents from different fields. We also have $30 billion of co-investment fund. And the newly set up Hong Kong Investment Company Limited will manage the fund. Through co-investment, we will assist enterprises that have great potentials. The government will also consolidate our advantages and will develop a new development impetus that includes consolidating our status as an international financial services center and will actively promote ourselves as an innovation center. Within last year, we have introduced a bill to provide waiver of a profits tax for family-owned investment vehicles to enable them to expand their businesses in Hong Kong. We have also introduced an amendment to the stamp duty to launch the dual counter market maker scheme. On innovation and technology, we have launched an innovation technology blueprint. We will actively develop Hong Kong into an INT center. Apart from this blueprint, we have also launched a blueprint for primary healthcare and a blueprint for youth development. These are to take forward the measures mentioned in the policy address. There is also the District Matters Coordination Task Force headed by the Chief Secretary for Administration. We have cleansed over 650 black spots and have maintained the environmental hygiene of over 3,700 public places. We've also clamped down on serious cases of hygienic problems locations like Chunyang Street in Wan Chai and Kennedy Road West, Soi Wo Street, and Lung Fong Garden in the northern district. We have also cleaned over 100 rear alleys to clear the obstruction, to keep them clear of any obstructions. We will also clean at least 75% of the confirmed black spots for hygiene problems. In terms of the relationship between the executive and the legislature, we think that we have been faring quite well. In the past 6 months, we have had 6 anti-chamber exchange sessions. The government has introduced 25 bills. 20 of them have completed their scrutiny and have been passed. We plan to introduce over 30 items on the legislative program. This fully shows that we have a healthy interaction and we complement one another. And this shows our spirit as patriots administering Hong Kong and our spirit of pragmatism. Built on the anti-chamber exchange sessions, we will enhance our communication and interaction with members. I would also like to take this opportunity to look forward to our work in the first half of 2023. First of all, with the consent and support of the central authorities, on the 8th of January, we have opened our borders with the mainland. All these boundary control points have been operating smoothly. All these arrangements have been done in an orderly and safe manner. The Hong Kong Shenzhen Guangzhou high speed rail resumed operation in the last Sunday. And we have increased the number of tickets available to 20,000. Between the 8th and the 18th of January, on a daily basis, over 20,000 people use the service. So over 200,000 people have made use of the land boundary control points to travel to the mainland. I thank relevant mainland authorities, the Shenzhen Municipal Government for their work, so that within a very short time, we have reopened our borders. The coordination group on resumption of normal travel headed by the Chief Secretary has been closely liaising with Shenzhen authorities to ensure that the operation is done in an orderly manner, and we're all ready to make adjustments as necessary. We have increased the number of quotas on our land boundary control points. Between the 27th and the 30th day of the last month, we have increased the number of quota to 65,000, including other control points without any quotas. We enable over 80,000 people per day to travel to the mainland over the Chinese New Year. With the Shenzhen and Guangdong province, provincial government will maintain close liaison and communication. We will work towards preparations for the next step for a full opening of our borders. With this, I myself and my team will visit Guangdong as soon as possible. We will talk to Guangdong province, provincial leaders, and leaders of other cities to have exchange sessions to work towards the development of the GBA. At the end of March, I will attend the Baoao Asian Forum. With the reconnection with the mainland and other places of the world, I believe that travel by air, sea, and land will become normal. The volume of travel will increase. Our economy will revive. With a change, positive change in the economic environment, our GDP will climb again. We have to seize these great opportunities. We need to work hard and floor the pedal towards economic revival. I myself and my team will actively visit other places and tell good stories of Hong Kong. We will also work with the business sector, professional services, and trade sector to promote Hong Kong. The government will organize a series of events, including international seminars, exhibitions, mega events, as well as sports events. At the beginning of next month, there will be a series of large-scale Hello Hong Kong publicity campaign. We will promote Hong Kong to the international arena that we have resumed normalcy. We will work with the Tourism Commission as well as the Tourism Board to attract visitors from the mainland and from other places for them to come back to Hong Kong. In the first half of this year, we will launch various mega events, including the Hong Kong Marathon, Hong Kong Rugby Sevens 2023, and other major events. We will also have Arts at Hong Kong, Flower Show, and Basel Art Hong Kong Exhibition, and Museum Summit, and the first ever popular art exhibition. In addition to other international seminars, we will see many such events that includes a jewelry show. Starting from this year, we will make use of the art and mega event fund to support these events to reinvigorate Hong Kong. The Hong Kong Sports Park will complete by phases within this year. We will marry it with technology and the East Kowloon Cultural Center. The East Kowloon area will be an important breeding ground for our arts talents. In November last year, in Bangkok, I attended APEC Summit. I will, at the beginning of February, visit UAE as well as Saudi Arabia. The delegation includes the Deputy Chief Secretary as well as Department Secretaries as well as trade delegations of Hong Kong. I will attend trade and art events and meet with people from these sectors. This is the 10th anniversary of the Belt and Road Initiative. I will seize the opportunity of these visits to strengthen our relationship with Saudi Arabia and the UAE to bolster our liaison with them in terms of commerce and trade, in terms of infrastructure. A number of these projects will start in 2023 on railway lines. In the Northern Line, Siuho Wan Station, Kutong Station, Tong Chong Extension, Tumun South Extension will start in 2023. In the first quarter of this year, we will work with the Shenzhen authorities to work the Western Rail of Hong Kong Shenzhen Railway and the Qianhai Extension. In terms of the Northern Metropolis, the dedicated unit will be set up this year. We will focus on working out our plans and work an action plan to coordinate departments and bureaus on various projects. There will be a blueprint announced to set out clearly the development objective. In terms of safeguarding our national security, at the end of last year, the NPCSC, in relation to Article 14 and 47, interpreted the national security law. It has been made clear that the Committee for Safeguarding National Security of the Hong Kong SAR has an important role to play. I am the chairperson of the committee. I will take up the responsibility of safeguarding national security. The Hong Kong SAR government will, as soon as possible, amend the Legal Practitioners Ordinance to address the issue of people without full permit to practice in Hong Kong in dealing with cases involving national security. We will also, as soon as possible, complete the legislative work of Article 23 of the Basic Law. President, members, I truly believe that 2023 will be a fruitful year. The Hong Kong SAR, under the sound constitutional framework of the One Country, Two Systems, as well as the support of our country, we leverage on our proximity to our country, and we are well connected to the rest of the world. In this new journey, we have plenty of opportunities and a very bright future. Before I answer members' questions, I would like to tell you all that there is an important step to be taken before resumption of normalcy. This is about the isolation order. I announce that I've decided to remove the isolation order. Confirmed cases under 599A of Prevention and Control of Diseases Ordinance will not be put under isolation order. This will be removed on the 30th of January. I have made the decision based on these factors. First, vaccination rate for second dose and the third dose in Hong Kong have reached 93% and 84%. In addition, in the fifth wave of the outbreak, large number of our population have been infected and they have had their antibodies boosted, which means that the effective vaccination rate, it has been pushed up to 95%. We have a very sound barrier of immunity. Those who have been vaccinated, if they contract Omicron, most of these cases exhibit mild symptoms. With the 3 years of fighting the epidemic and the evolvement of the virus, coupled with our enhanced capacity to fight the epidemic and effective medication available, our risk level has changed and has been reduced. We have opened our borders for over 10 days. The risk of infection has not been increased. The epidemic situation has been alleviating. The number of cases has dropped from 30,000 at the peak to about 3,000, a drop by about 90%. Fourthly, our understanding of COVID-19 and how to deal with it has been greatly enhanced. As a result, the government's management approach will have to change. Most of these infected cases are mild. So, and across the board of a mandatory approach by the government should be changed to a voluntary approach by members of the public. COVID-19 will be managed just as any other upper respiratory diseases. This important step is based on scientific evidence and is risk-based. This is an inevitable step experienced by overseas countries, and is one for Hong Kong. We have reached this stage. This afternoon, the Health Bureau will hold a press conference to give you details of the arrangements of the removal of the isolation order. I will now answer members' questions. Thank you.
Chief Executive will answer questions from members. Members who wish to ask questions, please press the Request to Speak button. I've informed members via the Secretariat that to make good use of the available meeting time to allow more members to put questions to the Chief Executive, 3 minutes will be allowed for asking and answering of each question. The time for asking a question by a member should not exceed 1.5 minutes to allow time for the Chief Executive to give his reply. Questions raised by members should be as concise as possible. Members should not make arguments when asking questions. Mr. Chairman Kwong, Chief Executive, I'm sure you know very well that Chinese medicine and collaboration between the Western and Chinese medicine have played a pivotal role in fighting the COVID pandemic. However, the progress of further collaboration in Hong Kong has been slow. Since 2014, the hospital authority introduced the collaboration service to provide relief for cancer treatment and pain relief. But at the moment, the collaboration still only focuses on the 3 kinds of diseases I mentioned. We enjoy inherent advantage when it comes to collaboration of Western and Chinese medicine because we have the practitioners on both sides. We also have research personnel. But there is no government policy support, and these opportunities have gone to waste. My question is whether the government will formulate a comprehensive policy on Western Chinese medicine collaboration. Chief Executive, thank you, Mr. Chan, for your questions. The policy address sets out the Hong Kong government's recognition of Chinese medicine and the essential role that Chinese medicine plays in our healthcare system. We have a Chinese medicine hospital. We also have the post of Commissioner of Chinese Medicine, who will conduct a comprehensive review on the system to ensure that Chinese medicine can make greater contribution to the healthcare system. Now, there are diseases that can be treated through collaboration of Chinese and Western medicine. First and foremost, Chinese medicine provides support and enrich the treatment plan for these diseases. And the scope of this service can be expanded to other clinics. In order to promote the development of Chinese medicine, first of all, we need to improve the system. And that entails training for Chinese medicine practitioners and collaboration with mainland authorities in stepping up training and promoting the research on Chinese medicine and setting standards for Chinese medicine. We also need to enhance public awareness. policy-wise, our direction is very clear. We want to make Chinese medicine a profession. We want to have better integration of Chinese medicine into our Western medicine-based healthcare system so that we can showcase the advantages of using Chinese medicine to treat certain diseases. And we will discuss and explore with the Chinese and Western medicine professions to map our way forward. And of course, I should invite Mr. Chan to offer his invaluable input in this regard. We need to tap collective wisdom, and the government is dedicated to further promote the development of Chinese medicine. I understand that small steps have been taken. In fact, in terms of referral of patients by Chinese medical practitioners for X-ray examinations and other lab tests, meetings should be held to discuss how we can further leverage on the CM sector. Now, as far as our healthcare system is concerned, we have a Western medicine-based system. Now, the government is promoting the development of primary care, and Chinese medicine plays a pivotal role in this regard, especially in terms of recuperation and the overall physical well-being. Definitely, Chinese medicine can make significant contributions to the government's work. So as we chart our way forward on drawing up a blueprint on Chinese medicine's development, I would invite Mr. Chan and other stakeholders to provide input. Mr. Adrian Ho, according to government papers, between 2022-23, recurrent government expenditure increased by $70 billion, up by 16.4% comparing to last year. And between 2017-18 to 2021-22, the recurrent expenditure increased by 36.3%, for welfare 48.7%, healthcare 57%, and education 21.2%. At the same time, there have been fluctuations in the government revenue for stamp duty, land sale income, so on and so forth. They account for 68% of all government revenue. And it's the third year that we have a deficit. Balancing the books is important to the long-term development of Hong Kong. So my question is how the government will balance the books and ensure that we have sufficient income to support expenditures on infrastructure and other development projects. I thank Mr. Adrian Ho for his concern. The Financial Secretary is now conducting budget consultation. So he is the one to answer Mr. Ho's question, and I believe that the Financial Secretary will sincerely listen to views from different sectors of the community, and I thank Mr. Adrian Ho for making constructive comments to the Financial Secretary for his consideration. Now, in terms of the fiscal position of the government and how we balance the books, Mr. Ho referred to the government's revenue and public spendings, and the figures he quoted reflect what happened during the three-year epidemic in Hong Kong. And we should be glad that we are seeing light at the end of the tunnel, be it reconnection with the world and enhancing our connectivity with the mainland. We have a lot of potential to enhance connectivity. And comparing to what we've experienced in the past 3 years because of COVID, I remain optimistic. It's a switch from minus to plus. And yet we need to be cautious. The global interest rate hike is still in place, and there are also geopolitical tensions. In fact, it's just been announced that for our country's GDP or the GNP, it has gone up by 3%. So this is another positive factor. Externally, there are global challenges. But as far as our country's development is concerned, the locomotive remains in place, and we're foreseeing a more positive growth. So the question for us is how we can also have economic gain in line with the country's development. And as I said, we're going to roll out a number of initiatives. We have more opportunities to help us overcome challenges. In the past 3 years, in midst of the COVID epidemic, there were a lot of difficulties for us. But now, with resumption of normal travel and return to normalcy, there is a lot of expectations from the community. And I have been listening to the views of the tourism sector and the business sector, and these different sectors have been very active in working with the government. So I will make sure that we will spare no effort in this regard. Now we need to be pragmatic and have regard to the global perspective. My second point is, in terms of government revenue, then we may not be able to tap new sources. There is limited room because there is public may need to foot the bill if we are to tap new sources of revenue. So what we do now is to go deeper and go wider. For example, we have the positioning of the 8 centers. So we need to enhance the breadth and the depth, and also grasp the opportunities presented to us by the country's development. The other point is, we need to go for high quality development. Now, I believe the public, like myself, are concerned with industrialization 4.0. And if we're able to incorporate high value added elements, we'll be able to generate a bigger income. In other words, if we take forward high-quality development in the different economic sectors, we can achieve greater results. So this is something that we'll consider. For example, in terms of innovation technology, we will spare no effort in establishing Hong Kong as an international innovation and technology center. I believe that as a result, we will see an increase in income in these areas.
Dr. David Lam. Thank you, President. The development of primary healthcare relies on service by various healthcare disciplines. But in the community, it's not like the hospital. We need professionals. That is, professional registration of healthcare practitioners. However, when it comes to speech therapists, dietitians, clinical psychologists, and audiologists, needs professional registration. For the voluntary registration scheme, it has been in place for 6 years. For these disciplines, we have a sound registration system and has been verified repeatedly by the Department of Health. What is lacking is a statutory registration. Do you have a timetable to launch a statutory registration for these five disciplines? Dr. Lam has pointed out a crucial point. Professional registration was floated 6 years ago, so it was done not in the previous government but the government before. It was a pilot scheme put forward by the government before the last. I'm also concerned about this issue. Well, I do think that after 6 years, we do need to give this issue more thought, even though it's not mentioned in my policy address. Registration on a voluntary basis will have to be verified by professional bodies to give accreditation to the professionalism of these disciplines. You have mentioned five disciplines. What are the criteria for professional registration? I have asked relevant colleges to give me a report to see what standards they should be reached and what training need to be provided. I ask for reports to be submitted and I will consider them. This before we map out the next step. Mr. Chiang Hai-Long, thank you, President. Yesterday, I attended an event to select the 10 major pieces of news. I'm sure that opening of the border will be one of the major piece of news in 2023, because it has been on our mind all the time. Well, since you have taken office, we now see the actual opening of the border. However, we see that last night there are a lot of people queuing up to get tested in Maple Street. People are worried that after the Chinese New Year, they may not be able to get a PCR test done to come back to Hong Kong. I do think that the arrangement of crossing the border has been improved. But my question is, what work have you done in relation to the opening of the border? How do you score yourself out of 100, Chief Executive? When people ask me to give myself points, I only focus on myself because it is for the general public to assess the performance of my team. Of course, I have standards and I ask my teams to reach these standards, but we can always improve. Whenever there are problems and issues, they will be tasked to address these issues and make improvements. A government is here to solve problems. I can see that members of the public have to queue to get tested. Of course, this is not satisfactory and will have to be handled. We have to find out where the problem lies. Is it the case that we have not provided sufficient number of testing centers? The answer is no. Even with queues, the capacity of our testing centers only reach 60%. So what is lacking is flow of information for members of the public to know where to go and to avoid queues at certain stations and centers. They can simply go to a different center with available slots. I notice a news report. I thank the media for doing that. There are at least 20 testing centers with available slots. In the same district, reporters have visited two centers, one with queues, the other, no. One is a McPherson playground in Mong Kok. Well, up to the 20th, slots have been full, but in Arthur Street, there are still available slots. I am the chief executive. When I see members of the public having to queue for hours, it makes me sad. And I put myself in their shoes to feel how they feel. I have asked the Health Bureau and the Innovation and Technology Bureau to improve the availability and dissemination of information so that available slots of 40% of our capacity can be made known to the public so that they can be fully used. I asked them to do some work to more effectively release the information. And the public will have to be informed about the different time slots. For, say, one center, it may be the largest center of all, but when everyone goes there, there will be queues. And this situation will have to be disseminated. For traveling across the border, we have an advanced booking system because we don't want people to just bunch up during a certain time slot. Of course, people want to go to a location that's most convenient to them, and they can go to get tested on their way to and back from work. But if people want to go to popular centers, and if they know that if they go to somewhere that is further away, they could have saved half an hour or 20 minutes, and then they may change their mind. And the information will have to be readily available and easy to understand. Of course, we will listen to views, and when there is room to improve, we will definitely do so. I'm sure that there are new problems every day, no matter how many we have resolved. But I'd like to stress one point. My goal is to do away with PCR tests. My goal is to replace PCR tests with RAT tests. And my ultimate goal is to dispense with RATs. And I've already made a decision to remove the isolation order. An important step, as I said, towards normalcy is to remove isolation orders. But of course, in certain circumstances, we have to protect vulnerable groups and groups that are subject to high risk. For the general public, of course, I hope that there won't be any restrictions. That is the true meaning of normalcy. But at a certain time, before we make major changes, we need to make adjustments. And there is an adjustment period where we have to address different issues and tackle problems. I'm sure that members of the public are most happy to abide by our requirements, but they need the information. So what I want to tell the public is that there is surplus slots and surplus capacity. Even with yesterday's situation, only 60% of our capacity was used. And of course, if any of you see any problems anywhere, please talk to our departments. Let's say, for example, the Home Affairs Department. I hope that relevant information will be made available as soon as possible.
Professor William Wong, Chief Executive, in the 14th five-year plan, the central authorities support Hong Kong's establishment as a regional IP trading center. In fact, yesterday there was a discussion on this topic. I understand that the CEDB is in charge of this policy area, but patent is also one important point, and patent involves technology transfer. So, Chief Executive, will you consider allowing the Innovation Technology and Industry Bureau to take charge of this matter in the future? I thank Professor Wong for his question. In policy formulation, we often face a very practical issue. In fact, this is not unique to our government. It is also a common issue facing governments in other countries. There may be overlapping of policy portfolios. There may be gaps. So we need to, first of all, be aware of this issue in reality, and then consider how we can achieve effectiveness in policy formulation. Now, Professor Wong refers to technology, and in fact, we also have patents for designs in the creative industries. So it is difficult to have a dedicated department to oversee matters relating to IPs in technology transfers in, say, art design, graphic design. I think what is important is that we need to identify the crucial links, and then we need to find out the responsible policy bureaus, and then we need to identify gaps. Let's say if there is a gap, if the relevant department does not have the legal mandate, the department may say that it has nothing to do with this matter, and then it's for me to give a direction for the department to take it up. Of course, this is also the purpose of my creating the post of Deputy Department Secretaries. And in fact, all the way down to bureau chiefs and other department leaders and heads, even down to the middle level offices, they are all responsible. So to answer your question, we need to do our level best and see what system works best. Of course, when it comes to innovation technology, the ITIB would be in the best position to take it up. So this will be the major bureau responsible. But when it comes to intellectual property. We need to have regard to the legal framework. We need to have regard to international standards and also professionals who can meet the international training requirements. So I believe at least as far as the current system is, I believe that this is the most effective way. Mr. Yeo Pak-leung, Chief Executive, first of all, I thank you for your efforts in striving for resumption of quarantine-free travel with the mainland. Well, we are the hardest hit industry. The tourism industry has faced a lot of difficulties in the past 3 years. I will let the data speak. Well, regarding the outbound travel duty, according to the TIA, there was only 30%, and in 2022, only 600,000 inbound travelers were received. As for hotel vacancy rate, the take-up rate was 63%. The prices also plummeted. Even for the Chinese New Year, only 70% of, or less than 70% of hotel rooms have been booked. We rely on locals, in other words. And we understand that as for the aviation industry, it's now working only at the 30% of its capacity. So we're now still at the very initial step of reviving the industry. We need the government's support. You mentioned that in February, a major publicity campaign will be launched to attract tourists to come to Hong Kong. Now, what measures will the government roll out to help revive our industry? Chief Executive. First of all, I thank Mr. Yu for expressing concern about his sector. And as Chief Executive, I also feel his passion and devotion for his industry and for his comments to the SAR government. They are meticulous, and I understand that the tourism industry has been the hardest hit industry in the past 3 years. And we have been going the extra mile in helping this industry under the anti-epidemic fund and other subsidy schemes. Since reopening the border on the 8th of January, if we take a look at the travel figures, I would say that we only reached 10% of the pre-epidemic level. Or just 7% on weekends and major holidays, comparing to the pre-epidemic level. So it will take some time before we see a true revival of the economy. We still have some measures in place under the anti-epidemic fund. For example, we subsidize the running of green eco tours and heritage tours. And we also provide training subsidies to enhance the professional aspect of the industry. Now, I understand that it will take some time for the capacity of the industry to be resumed. So if there is anything that the SAR government can do to enhance the system in general, do give us comments. For example, about cross-boundary vehicles, doing business across the border, we are going to enhance the capacity of vehicle examination. The SAR government strives to meet demand. But on cross-boundary issues, we need to work with the other government as well. And on cross-boundary vehicles, the Transport and Logistics Bureau and the Security Bureau are sparing no effort in this regard, because the Public Security Bureau of the mainland is responsible for vehicle examination. There are still problems to be resolved, but I appeal to your understanding that the government is indeed making an all-out effort in tackling them. Say, for leasing space, for the parking of coaches, the government also makes an all-out effort. And we want to shorten this transitional period as much as possible. And a joint effort is required. We need to mobilize everyone to tell the good stories of Hong Kong. We need to make an extra effort, and that is why I'm going to lead delegations to tell the world the good stories of Hong Kong. And the financial secretary, meanwhile, is also doing the same. So do tell us your comments so that we can work harder.
Mr. Lam Eng Kwong. Thank you. Well, we have quarantine-free cross-boundary travel with PCR test within 48 hours. But the arrangements of the two places are different. A lot of the mainland testing centers will be on holiday till the 8th day of the Chinese New Year. So when people want to come back, it's difficult for them to get tested. And if they try to find available slots online, they find the information is not updated. And that happens frequently. Some people want to go back to the mainland to visit their relatives, but they have to queue for a very long time. Last night till 3 a.m., a lot of the people who work at these centers work round the clock. For families that have to go across the border, it will cost them several hundred dollars for the tests. So I'd like to ask the chief executive, in view of the situation, will you continue discussion with mainland authorities? Will you give us good news that perhaps before or after the new year you'll be able to reach your objectives? That is to replace PCR tests with RAT or dispense with tests so that families can happily go to the mainland to spend the Chinese New Year. Thank you. Our communication with mainland authorities happens every single day. On different areas, our government departments talk to relevant mainland counterparts. Under the leadership of the Chief Secretary, we have the Coordination Group of Resumption of Normal Travel. As you can see, that whenever we see problems, they'll be ironed out. It's mentioned that children under the age of 3, they don't have to do PCR tests when they come back to Hong Kong, but when it comes to the other way around, we'll need to the consent of mainland authorities. We've already talked to them, and it's decided that the test for people under the age of 3 will be dispensed with. And I'm very clear that we need to dispense with PCR tests. But when will it happen? As I said, that it involves three parties apart from the SAR government, and there is the Guangdong provincial government and the central authorities. I can tell you that we have the same goal? But there is a procedure and a process to go through by all three parties. We are unable to divulge every details, but I can tell you that with every discussion, there is improvement. You hear about it once every 2-3 days. And this, back to the point I mentioned, we talk every day and we make progress within very short time. I do agree that before PCR tests are dispensed with, there are some other problems that we need to address. It may not happen overnight, but we do hope that if we can do it as soon as possible, we will do it. And I would like to surprise you with good news. We have good intentions, but at the same time, we have to plant our feet on the ground firmly. We need to identify areas that are within our control. For these, we're more confident. And there are areas that we need consent of all three parties. Regarding PCR tests, it's an issue that involves all three parties. You need to give us time, but I am optimistic. In a medium term, I'm aware of the unsatisfactory situation yesterday. However, the capacity was only 60%. We need to disseminate information effectively for the general public to know. With the mainland, there are designated portals where you can visit to get information. So if you have access to such information, then you will get accurate information and there won't be any wasted trips. Well, you need to make available information and make it available effectively so that members of the public will be fully informed. And I've been asking relevant bureaus and departments to communicate all information well to the general public. And whenever they hear about problems, they should be resolved. In terms of replacement of PCR tests with RAT and on which area we can start with, we will have to map it out. Regarding students, well, they should be given priorities. That is very clear. That is in terms of cross-boundary students. That is well within our control and is easier to handle. Members of the public know about the work undertaken by the government and the degree of difficulty of these tasks. Well, when they are fully informed, then they will have more confidence. Dr. So Cheung-Wing, Hong Kong is the biggest offshore renminbi business hub. We have uniqueness that is not present in London and New York. This is a good diversification of our over-reliance of US dollars, and this will promote the internationalization of RMB. And it will also boost the liquidity of RMB, and it will also expand our securities and bond market, and this will complement influx of capital in the GBA. I'm glad to hear in the policy address that the government will strengthen our advantage as the global renminbi offshore business hub. However, I have not seen any measures launched. In order to strengthen our advantage, has the government keep themselves fully aware of relevant standards? Have you garnered support from the central authorities? And in relation to RMB investment tools, that is a key area. Dr. So, you are only allowed one question. Chief Executive. Mr. So's concern is the use of renminbi businesses by Hong Kong as an international financial center. We have the largest renminbi liquidity pool. There are some directions set in a policy address. When it comes to details, we will have to seize every single opportunity to advance our position. Our advantage is that we are the largest renminbi offshore business hub. We have about 800 billion renminbi, and over 70% of these offshore transactions take place in Hong Kong. As I previously mentioned, whether it is to increase our revenue or expand our markets, or the strengthening of our position as an international financial center, I think that the most effective way is to deepen the depth and widen the breadth. We need to make good use of global trends, which lies in a green bond. Municipal governments, provincial governments have been issuing bonds, RMB bonds. We have the duty to promote the internationalization of RMB. In the promotion of various RMB investment tools, we have been working on it and developing it. With the dual counter approach, with the dual tranche, it has been, the bill has been passed. This is conducive to widening the breadth and depth of RMB business. And every time I visit overseas or with visits but done by the financial secretary, the monetary authority, or the financial services and the treasury, we have been stressing our development of RMB businesses. In some overseas countries, they use RMB in their transaction. How do they make good use of RMB, but with so that it can be used in a diversified way? Regarding wealth asset management and liquidity, and I have been showcasing Hong Kong's position. A lot of investors use Hong Kong to boost the liquidity of RMB. Regarding the southbound trading and northbound trading of Stock Connect, of course, we would like to see more RMB products. There are also some derivative products that are denominated in RMB. There are many ways to promote these products. There are suggestions made by people who hold renminbi assets. And we seriously consider these suggestions. The Hong Kong Exchange will also look into them. Say for ETF denominated in renminbi, and derivatives in RMB, we are looking into them, and we will disseminate information when it's available.
Mr. Stanley Ng. Thank you, President. As the Chinese New Year approaches, may I first of all wish you, Chief Executive, prosperity and the prosperity of Hong Kong under your leadership. Now, we wrote spring couplets, and I started with this one, which means turning from order to prosperity. And in order to achieve that, we need to work with concerted efforts so that we all make constructive contributions to strive for prosperity to be shared among all. In other words, we need to stay united, and it is important to enhance people's sense of happiness and sense of achievement. And that is why, on our path to resuming normalcy, a fund should be set up to help people with jobs so that businesses will thrive. So as we enter a new phase of prosperity after restoring order from chaos, there should be more government policies to enhance people's sense of happiness. Chief Executive, I thank Mr. Ng for illustrating what exactly this phrase means. For example, he asked for funds to be set up to help people with jobs and to help businesses. We need to take a multi-pronged approach. Now, the member mentioned providing subsidies, but we also need to gauge the actual situation and who are the most needy. We must bear in mind that we have been in a trough for the past 3 years, and as we move towards normalcy, we need to have a diversity of measures. So monetary assistance is just one option. Now, Mr. Ng, you just now mentioned making joint efforts and staying united. And in fact, this is also the theme of my election manifesto. We need to work with one heart, and we also need to have to work as a team in taking this result-oriented approach. We need to work with one heart, one mind, and we need to act together. I believe that this is important. I attach great importance to working as a team. That is why when I visit overseas, I lead the relevant delegations. Usually, the delegations are related to the trade, to attracting enterprises, to helping different sectors. So we take a multi-pronged approach because there are different things that different countries find Hong Kong attractive. Some are interested in the business opportunities here. Some appreciate the diversity of events, sports events, competitions, festivals and trendy events held in Hong Kong. And I fully agree with the Honourable Member that we need to enhance the sense of happiness among our people. Apart from providing monetary assistance, if need be, we may consider measures to help us achieve normalcy more expeditiously. However, we should work on a united front and widen the scope in promoting Hong Kong and grasping opportunities. I believe that this will help us achieve normalcy more expeditiously. Mr. Xu Kuo-Kang, President, Chief Executive, the government has announced that for cross-boundary students, they can attend face-to-face classes. This is good news to them. It's been 3 years since they haven't been able to do so. This will help enhance their physical well-being and mental well-being. I believe that the chief executive and the bureau chiefs are concerned about these students, and they will do whatever they can to help them. However, for students living near Châteauroux, as Châteauroux border has not been fully open, students need to take an extra 2-hour journey to and from the school every day. Now, will the government liaise with the mainland counterparts as quickly as possible to open up Chongying Street so that students don't need to take long journeys when they attend classes? I thank the honourable member for his concern for cross-boundary students and the concern for Châteauroux BCP. And in fact, when we discuss reopening the border, we also discuss the same issue. However, we need to reach a consensus. We've raised our concern at the same time. We need to be mindful of the fact that there may be obstacles to overcome. There may be difficulties not known to us. And the Security Bureau, in this regard, has adopted an innovative approach and implemented quite some innovative measures in the arrangements. We may not have announced every detail, but adopting the same spirit, I'm sure the Security Bureau Chief will continue to be engaged in this matter. And I'm sure that your concern is shared by many. In the course of our discussion with the mainland counterparts, I'm sure that all these points will be covered. Mr. Chan Xiuhong, Chief Executive, first of all, I thank you and your team for your hard work in this new term, for Hong Kong to resume normal travel arrangements, for families to be reunited after 3 years, so that we see hope as we turn a new chapter. But according to many people, they are concerned. On the one hand, they're excited about the reopening of borders, but they are also worried that these arrangements will lead to emergence of new variants and more infections. And should this happen, it will pose pressure on the public healthcare system in Hong Kong. Now, Chief Executive, you just announced that the isolation order will be scrapped after the Chinese New Year, and you also cited 5 factors for your consideration. I believe you have considered them thoroughly before making this decision, and details will be announced further by the Health Chief this afternoon. Now, Chief Executive, what measures will be adopted by the government to ensure that there will not be a resurgence of local infections, so that there won't be a squeeze on the supply of medicine, so that we'll continue to enjoy normalcy?
Chief Executive, I thank Mr. Chen for his reminders and his concern. And I'm grateful for your words of encouragement and appreciation. I am the Chief Executive. It's my job to do well. And if I don't do well enough, I have to strive to do better. So I welcome comments and views. Opening the border is a major issue and is good news. I am the Chief Executive. This is good news. And this is good news to everyone, and we don't want any blemish. So I attach a lot of importance to this. As a result, I have asked the Chief Secretary to lead the relevant group. Opening the border is not just about the border. There are other issues that have to be addressed by the coordination group on resumption of normal travel. Citing an example is availability of drugs and medication. That is discussed by the coordination group, and I have asked about it. The Health Bureau has liaised with pharmaceutical company representatives and pharmaceutical manufacturers. They are trying to find solution. It seems that the situation is under control, but it doesn't mean that it won't one day get out of control. I do find certain principles very useful. We need to tell members of the public about these problems in a courageous way. We tell the public that, there may be certain situations happening, because people don't like it when the government's in the dark. So we need to tell the public that we're aware of the problems and that we're working on it. When we work on the problem, we need to tell the public the difficulties we encounter when trying to resolve the problem. Say, for example, long queues for testing centers. We need to tell the public that it's not a matter of short in supply. We have spare 40% of capacity. We need to have a right diagnosis of the situation and apply the right solution. Issues related to opening of the border is something that we have encountered before. Say, for example, parallel goods, obstruction of streets, hygiene problems. These are issues that the coordination group will tackle. The Deputy Chief Secretary has set up a unit to handle that as well. What is the crucial issue involved? We need to identify potential hazards, risk. We need to identify safety coefficients. We need to formulate contingency plans. And these are issues to be handled by the coordination group. Well, and as to whether there will be a resurgence of the epidemic, and of course, we should stay vigilant. The epidemic situation may take a different turn at any time. We have to be fully prepared. It's just like before the fifth wave, when Omicron first emerged, it caught the whole world by surprise with its high transmissibility. One of our policy in the fight against the epidemic is to guard against resurgence. In the past 6 months, when this government's doing its best to work towards normalcy, we see that the situation is a recurrence, something that we have seen before. Say, for example, we remove centralized isolation, and then there is zero plus three quarantine. When we look back, we realize that we have handled it well. We handle it in a safe and orderly manner. We will actively work on it. And we want the general public to think that we have done well enough. We are fully alive to the situation that there may be many unexpected situations that will emerge, and it's a piece of information that I share every day with my team. And I can tell the member that we stay vigilant. If you identified any weak links, please let us know. Staying vigilant is a good thing. Opening the border is a good thing. It's always a good thing. Mr. Xu Kafai. Hello, Chief Executive. Previously, I asked the former Chief Executive, Mrs. Carrie Lam, that a colorful participation from people of different political spectrum here is a good thing. In your policy address, I see that you have focused on attracting enterprises and talents. If that is the case, then the business sector will shine again. But if you want to develop the economy and to attract businesses and talents, then you need more work. Tommy Jung told me that there is a manpower shortage of 30,000. Frankie Yik told us that in the transport sector, drivers are usually in their 70s and there is a manpower shortage. And for the F&B sector, last year, even if you raise the pay by 10 to 20%, you still have recruitment difficulties. And I heard from the construction sector that they are concerned about manpower shortage. And in the hotel industry, they are also worried about a shortage in staff. So would you consider importation of labor to address the issue?
Xu Yu.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Xu. Indeed, we have a wide spectrum in the community. And let me say, quote this saying in English. Well, it takes all sorts to make the world. And that is why equally in Hong Kong, we need people from all walks of life, from different backgrounds, to build the society here and to build a home for us. The business sector is a major contributor to our development. The business sector drives development, provides jobs, help us shine on the globe, on the world stage. At the same time, the labor sector provides the footing and that means people can make their ends meet, they can make a living, and the labor sector makes contribution. So that we maximize what we can share, because the labor sector is the largest sector in Hong Kong. Everyone in Hong Kong forms part of Hong Kong. Now, Mr. Xu, just now gave this analogy. It's like the brake lining that is heavily utilized day in, day out. But when you consider the merits of a car, you consider the horsepower instead of its brake lining. In other words, we need to make people feel that they've achieved something as they work hard, and we also need to play a role on the world stage, and that means jobs for drivers, professionals alike, and also other jobs in the retail industry, jobs for the grassroots, all these are important. In the policy address, we rolled out measures relating to the trial for talents. And Mr. Xu, if you could just refer to the policy address. You will find that we do have policies formulated on the basis of the manpower needed for different sectors. So for the logistics sector, we need to, it's for the Transport and Logistics Bureau to recruit, to address the issue of drivers shortage, and the Development Bureau is responsible for tackling the issue of manpower shortage in the construction industry. So different policy bureaus will assess the manpower needed in their respective portfolio in drawing up the measures to tackle them. Labor importation is one option, for example, for residential care homes for the elderly and the disabled. We're short of care workers, and I understand that the Labor and Welfare Bureau has launched a scheme, and 3,000 care workers will be imported to address the shortage. And at the moment, we have 4,000. We're short of 4,500 care workers. At the same time, we accord priority to local employment. And I believe the business sector also understands that we need to strike a balance. And these two issues are not in conflict. Now, Kafai, apart from what you said, we also have a talent list setting out the 13 professions with manpower shortage so that exemptions can be given without going through the local recruitment process. You can start recruit laborers elsewhere. And we covered the 13 trades. And I also ask the relevant bureau to submit a report to me as to whether we can include more trades. So let me just sum it up. We need to let the data speak. As usual, we adopt an objective stance in examining data. And I also task different policy bureaus to examine the relevant issues, so that, like Mr. Stanley Ng said, we stay united and make concerted efforts in tackling issues so that Hong Kong can become a home, an inclusive home for everybody. The Chief Executive's question and answer session ends. The Chief Executive will now leave the chamber. Will members please stand up? Members, this is the last meeting before the Chinese New Year. In a year of rabbit, I wish everyone prosperity and good health. I also hope that the Chief Executive will continue to lead Hong Kong to enter a new phase of prosperity in the year of rabbit. I now adjourn the council until 11 a.m. on Wednesday, 8th of February, 2023.